am Mr. Taru, here to finish our discussion of binomial settings and binomial distributions. Since a binomial setting or a binomial distribution is a class or type of discrete random variable, you can set up PDF tables using the binomcdf command from your calculator that will be under the distribution menu. So we've got the binomial distribution of n, p, or 5. N is 5, that's going to be the total of 5 number of trials and a 30% chance of success. And we're defining x as the number of successes. So the value of x can take on 0 successes out of 5 all the way up, well, to 5. You can have a success for every trial. And our PDF table has got the probabilities of 17%, 36%, and so on. All I did was just type in 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 into the binom PDF command of my calculator to get all those exact probabilities. Now, you can also accumulate those probabilities and make a cumulative distribution function. This type of cumulative probabilities is what allowed us to make ogive graphs when we were learning about histograms. And I got those by doing binomcdf with the n, p, and the number of successes. And I just added all those up. I rounded these off pretty badly, so my last two cells show a probability of 1. That's just round off error. So just be aware of that. Now let's talk about how we can handle binomial counts or binomial distributions without this idea of it being a discrete random variable. But actually it is, but if you have a large enough trial, or if you have a trial that's too large to maybe use your calculator with and use these binom PDF and CDF commands, you can do something called normal approximation. Also, our graphing calculators can only work with binomial distributions when they're in terms of a count. Later on, we're going to learn about how to deal with binomial proportions, which is exactly the same setting, only x is going to be defined as percentage of success and not number of success. And since our calculator cannot work with binomial settings in terms of proportions, this idea of normal approximation, which actually is not written on the board yet, but it will be on the next screen, is, you know, pretty important. Okay, so how do we find the mean and standard deviation of a binomial count? Well, the mean of this count, this binomial count, is n times p, and the standard deviation is the square root of n times p times 1 minus p. And if you're taking an AP stats class and you're going to take that test at the end of the year to try and get some college credit, these two formulas are on that formula sheet when you take the exam. Now, if you're talking about mean and standard deviations, especially standard deviation is not a valid measurement unless your distribution is normal. Remember we talked about normal probability plots? That was a graph that our graphing calculators could make automatically or your computer. To help check that your distribution, your univariate quantitative distribution, is indeed normal. So look that up, normal probability plot, if you've forgotten it. We covered it already this year. Well, the normality check for a binomial setting is right here. If n times p is greater than 10, and n times 1 minus p is greater than 10, then your sample is large enough for your binomial distribution to be, approximately normal, and thus you can let the bell curve and the z-score calculations approximate your answers instead of getting exact forms that we'll get from binom PDF and binom CDF. So let's see what that normal approximation looks like. Woo!
La 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 la. No 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 no.
There we go.
Okay. Normal approximation uses z-scores to estimate probabilities of desired events, like the probability that x, again, number of successes, is greater than a number, or less than a number, or whatever. So our example that we're going to walk through now, during the year's biggest holiday, I did make up these numbers by the way, it is estimated that 68% of people travel to see family. So if you survey 350 people, what is the probability that over 250 people in your survey say yes, they do travel to see family? Well, step one is to make sure that it's even a binomial setting. Just because it's a yes-no answer does not mean, you know, there's two outcomes for each trial. Does not mean that you're automatically into a binomial setting. You have four checks for that. Make sure there's only two outcomes. Make sure that you are asking a set number of observations. We are only going to ask 350 people. We're not going to keep going until we get our first yes. We're not going to keep going until 200 people say yes. We're going to ask a set number of people, 350, and so n is fixed. Independence. Well, usually your statement there is going to be, I'm doing an SRS and the population is over 10 times the sample size, so we have independence in this setting. All right, my probability of success is constant. It's going to be assumed to be a constant 68%. And this fifth check is not for the binomial setting, but this fifth check is for normality. And again, we cannot do normal approximation unless our distribution is actually normal. So that's n times p is greater than or equal to 10, and n times 1 minus p is also greater than or equal to 10. Both of those checks have to pass, otherwise your distribution is not normal, and you'll be forced to use binompdf or binomcdf in your calculator, and that's not really such a bad option as long as you're within you're working with binomial counts. Binomial proportions cannot be handled by you might be using computers and Minitab. I'm not really sure how those work, but I know your graphing calculators will not handle binomial proportions. All right, let's move on to the next screen and see what this example looks like. Woo! Okay, I humor myself. Okay, top three lines are in green because these top three lines are not approximate normal approximations. No, they're coming from our calculator, and let's just see what the answers come out to. The binomial, or the probability that x is greater than 250, is found by doing 1 minus binomcdf. If you have an Inspire, it will count down, but if you have a TI-83 and TI-84 to help you with this class, they do not count up. I think I said that wrong. If you have a TI Inspire, it'll do these inequalities whether they're less than or greater than, and you don't need to use the sort of subtraction idea that I have here, but most people use TI-83s and TI-84s. And for binomial count distributions, they are only capable of counting down. So I'm having to do 1 minus the binomcdf, the complement of x being greater than 250, the complement or the opposite of having 251 or 252 or 253 and so on, successes is to have 250 or less. So this command is counting down, which is what our 83s and 84s are capable of doing. Can you tell those the calculators most of my students use? So it's 1 minus binomcdf, and it comes out to be 7.5%, basically. Now, if I change that greater than symbol to greater than or equal to, and this is we're handling this as a discrete random variable, and that's what our calculators with the exact value commands will do, it will change the answer slightly, because there is probability of x equaling exactly 250. So 1 minus binomcdf, the opposite, you know, with n, p, and the number of successes, the complement to 250 or more, the complement or the opposite of 250, 251, 252 successes and so on, is 249 or less. So my last number's changed here a little bit, and my final answer has changed, 9.3% approximately. What would that look like as normal approximation, using a z-score calculation? Well, as soon as you set up a bell curve, and you calculate the mean and standard deviation of that variable, now you're using a bell curve, a mathematical model, to approximate the actual answer. And this is a smooth, continuous random variable. Did you hear what I just said? The bell curve is a smooth, continuous random variable. It's not going to be handled as a discrete random variable like binompdf and cdf are capable of doing with your calculator. So with this normal approximation, even though the binomial setting is technically a discrete random variable, once you go into normal approximation and you're using z-scores and bell curves, this now acts as, at least as far as the approximation goes, a continuous random variable. So the probability that x is greater than or equal to, or excuse me, the probability that x is greater than 250 is equal to the z-score, which is estimate minus parameter over standard deviation. That gives me a z-score of 1.37. Don't forget z-score is the unit of measure for z-score is the number of standard deviations your statistic is away from the mean. So 250 is 1.37 standard deviations to the right of 238. If you're using a chart to get your p-values, I stress the use of those because I feel like they build the basic understanding of statistics better than just using a calculator. So I'm getting the area shaded to the left in the chart that my book uses. So the entire area of the density curve is 1. I'm using we're pulling back some old concepts from chapters like 2 and 3 of my book, or, you know, topics I've discussed in videos quite a while back. So 1 minus 0.9147, this upper tail area therefore has an area of 0.0853, and our summary statement is the probability that more than 250 people say that they travel to see family out of a sample of 350, so I'm not really thrilled with my summary now that I'm reading it. The probability that more than 250 people say yes, they travel to see family out of a sample of 350 is 8.5%. Now, just to reiterate one more time that this is a normal approximation, and we're using a smooth, continuous bell curve to make that normal approximation. If I were to change the wording and say that I want the probability that X is greater than or equal to 250, that would not change my final p-value, would not change my final probability. It will, however, require me to change my wording. Your wording, your language, has to match your notation. So now would be the probability that 250 or more people say they travel to see family out of a sample size of 350. So there you go. We finish our discussion of binomial distributions. Now go do your homework.
Woo!
Bam! Thank you for watching. I do appreciate it, having the opportunity to help you out.